Hello students, welcome to NIUS. I am Dr. Padmaja Saxena, Assistant Professor, Dayal Singh College, University of Delhi. Today we will be discussing the chapter Renewable Sources of Energy, which is 29B. Now, as we know that the increasing population and change in our lifestyle make great demand for energy resources. The sources like sun and wind can never be exhausted and are thus known as renewable sources of energy. They cause no emission of poisonous gases and are available locally. They are widely available and potential source of clean and limitless sources of energy. So, in this lesson, we will study about such renewable sources of energy. So, the main objectives or the topics which we are going to cover are the definition of renewable sources of energy, distinction between renewable and non-renewable energy sources, different renewable sources of energy, the importance of solar energy, its functioning like the solar cooker, solar heater and solar cells, and methods of harnessing hydro energy and wind energy. So, first of all, energy sources. The energy sources can be categorized according to periods of usage, which can be conventional source of energy, which are easily available and have been in usage for a long time, or non-conventional source of energy that are other than the usual or that are different from those in the common practice. Now, conventional source of energy, these are of two types: conventional non-renewable energy, which includes fossil fuel under the ground, oil, petroleum and natural gas, while unconventional renewable energy sources, which include the fossil fuel above the ground, firewood, cattle dung, vegetable wastes, wood and charcoal. The non-conventional source of energy are solar energy, energy received from the sun, hydro energy received by water, wind energy generated by wind, nuclear energy which is generated by radioactive materials, hydrogen energy, energy generated by hydrogen, geothermal energy, energy obtained from underground, hot dry rocks, magma, hot water springs or natural geysers. Then biogas, the energy is derived from cow dung and vegetable wastes. Tidal energy, energy from waves and tidal waves of ocean and seas, they form energy. Then biofuel are the energy generated by non-edible oil and plants. Renewable or non-conventional sources of energy, the rapidly depleting fossil fuel sources of energy and escalating demand of energy have made it necessary to look for alternative sources of energy that are known as renewable or inexhaustible. So, inexhaustible energy resources are those resources which can be harnessed without depletion. So, among them, the first is the solar energy. Sun is an abundant source of energy and it is inexhaustible. Solar energy supports all life on earth and is the basis for almost every form of energy we use. The sun makes plants grow, which are burned as fuel or rot in swamps and are compressed underground for millions of years to become coal and oil. Heat from the sun causes temperature differences between areas, causing the wind to blow. Water evaporates due to heat of the sun. Vapors are carried to high elevations, and when the water vapors condense, it precipitates as rainfall. The water rushes down towards the sea through rivers to turbines for generating electricity. However, direct solar energy can be used as heat, light and electricity through the use of solar cells. Now, solar energy can be classified as direct solar energy, like solar energy is captured directly as sunlight and used for heating, generating electricity and cooling. The second way is indirect use of solar energy, which is derived from natural processes driven by the sun, for example, wind, biomass, waves, hydroelectric power. Direct solar energy. Direct use of solar energy can be used by various devices through systems that may be passive, active photovoltaic systems. So, we will first go to passive solar energy. Now, earliest uses of solar energy were passive in nature, such as to evaporate seawater for producing salt and for drying food and clothes, which is still being used for these purposes. The more recent passive use of solar energy is for cooking, heating, cooling, and for the daylighting of homes and buildings. The effectiveness of passive solar energy depends on good building design. It requires no mechanical means. Passive use of solar energy for cooking. When sun rays fall on a dark surface, it is absorbed and transformed into the heat energy. Glass is a bad conductor of heat, but if a shallow glass covered chamber painted black inside and insulated all around is exposed to sun for some time, the inside temperature exceeds up to 100 degrees centigrade and the food is cooked, as you can see in the figure. The solar cooker takes 5 to 6 hours to cook food. It is the device for direct use of renewable source of energy. In Indian conditions with plentiful sunshine, we can use a solar box cooker for cooking of food. The great advantage of solar cooking is its convenience because the food will never get overcooked or burnt. The food cooked in the solar cooker is also more tender and retains most of the nutritive values. But the disadvantages of such cooking is that it's a slow process and takes longer time in cooking. It is also not suitable on cloudy days. World's largest solar steam cooking system is operating in the Brahmakumari's ashram at Mount Abu in India. The solar energy is concentrated by a battery of concentrators or mirrors to convert water into superheated steam. The system can cook food for about 10,000 people. Passive use of solar energy for daylighting. Daylighting is using natural sunlight to light building interiors. Daylighting technologies are designed to maximize natural light for illuminating the interiors of buildings in the form of core lighting, when the building may have a central atrium to allow entry of maximum sunlight. The most recent technology is hybrid solar lighting, which collects sunlight and sends it through optical fibers into buildings where it is combined with electric light in hybrid light fixtures. There are sensors in the room which keep a steady lighting level by adjusting the electric lights based on the sunlight available. This new generation of lighting combines both electric and solar power. Advantage of passive solar systems are that they are maintenance free, there are no operating costs, results in substantial saving on electric bills. But it has disadvantages that passive solar heating, cooling and lighting system can be used only in specially designed buildings. Active use of solar energy. Active solar heating and cooling systems rely on solar collectors, which are usually mounted on roofs. Such systems also require pumps and motors to move the fluids or blow air by fan in order to deliver the captured heat. The main application of these systems is to provide hot water primarily for domestic use. Active solar heating is extensively used in India, Japan, Israel, Australia, and southern United States, which have sunny climate. So, this is the solar system for heating water. Solar energy to produce electricity. Solar energy is used to generate high temperature heat or electricity. solar collectors in deserts can produce high temperature heat to spin turbines for producing electricity. Solar thermal systems can collect and transform radiant energy received from the sun into high temperature thermal energy, which can be used directly or converted into electricity. Huge arrays of computer controlled mirrors called heliostats track the sun and focus sunlight on a central heat collecting tower. Disadvantage is that the cost of such devices are high. Then solar energy for cooling. A solar collector can also be used for cooling. In this system, energy from the sunlight powers a small heat engine similar to an electric motor of a refrigerator. The heat engine drives a piston that compresses a special vapor into a liquid. The liquid then re-vaporizes and draws heat out of the surrounding air. Solar cells or photovoltaic technology. Solar energy can be converted directly into electrical energy by photovoltaic cells, commonly called as solar cells. Photovoltaic cells are made up of silicon and other materials. When sunlight strikes the silicon atoms, it causes electrons to eject. A typical solar cell is a transparent wafer that contains a very thin semiconductor. Sunlight energizes and causes electrons in the semiconductor to flow, creating an electrical current. Solar cells can provide electricity to remote villages. India is the world's largest market for solar cells. We will now discuss about the uses of photovoltaic cells. Photovoltaic cell can be used for domestic lighting, street lighting, village lighting, water pumping, electrification, desalination of salty water, powering of remote telecommunication repeater stations and railway signals. Now we will discuss about the indirect solar energy. Indirect solar energy can be obtained in the form of wind energy, tidal energy, hydroelectric energy and biomass energy. Wind energy. About 2% of the sunlight striking the earth is converted into kinetic energy of moving air called wind. The uneven absorption of the solar radiation by the earth's surface causes differences of temperature, density and pressure, which produces air movements at local, regional and global levels powered by wind energy. The kinetic energy of wind can be harnessed by converting it into mechanical energy or electrical energy using suitable devices. As early as 4000 to 3500 BC, the first sailing ship and windmills were developed by harnessing wind energy. The wind has been used to power ships, grind grains, pump water for irrigation and do other types of work. Wind turbines like windmills are mounted on a tower to capture the most of the wind energy, as you can see in the diagram. Windmills can be used to derive generators to produce electricity. To produce electricity, wind is used to turn the shaft of a turbine, which is attached to a generator that produces electricity. Thus, wind turbines transform wind energy into mechanical power, which can be used to generate electricity. So these are the windmills which are used for generating electricity with the shaft. Five nations, USA, Germany, Denmark, Spain and India, account for 80% of the world's installed wind energy capacity. India is the fifth largest producer of wind power in the world. Andhra Pradesh generates maximum energy through wind power. Other states generating energy through wind are Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, Karnataka, Kerala, Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. A total of 26 project sites have been developed in these states, resulting in a capacity of 57 megawatts. Now, tidal energy. The energy of tides is harnessed as they flow in and out. The mean tidal range must be greater than 5 meters to produce energy. The tidal power is harnessed by building a dam across the entrance to a bay or estuary, creating a reservoir. As the tide rises, water is initially prevented from entering the bay. When the tides are high and water is sufficient to run the turbines, the dam is open and water flows through it into the reservoir, turning the blades of turbine and generating electricity. Again, when the reservoir is filled, the dam is closed, stopping the flow and holding the water in reservoir when the tide falls. The water level in the reservoir is higher than that in the ocean. The dam is then open to run the turbines, which are reversible. Electricity is produced as the water is let out of the reservoir. The dams built to harness the tidal power adversely affect the vegetation and wildlife. There are 40 tidal plants producing electricity. One in France is the only commercial power station operating in the world. In India, a major power project costing ₹5,000 crores is proposed to be set up in Hanthal Creek in the Gulf of Kutch in Gujarat. So, this is the diagram of a tidal power station, how it works. Then we come to the hydropower or hydroelectric energy. Hydroelectric power uses the kinetic energy of moving water to make electricity. Generation of electricity by using the force of falling water is called hydroelectricity or hydel power. Dams are built to store water at a higher level, which is made to fall to rotate turbines that generate electricity. The basic principle behind hydropower energy is the damming of rivers to create artificial waterfalls. Sometimes natural waterfalls are also used. The falling water is used to turn the turbines that drive electrical generators. One of the greatest advantages of hydropower is that it is cheaper and cleaner than thermal or nuclear power. But it has disadvantages also. The disadvantages of hydropower is that building of a dam disturbs and damages the natural habitat, and some of them are lost forever. Human habitations also get disturbed, making people homeless. So, these are some of the environmental effects of hydropower. So, this is all what we have done today. So, we can just summarize the topic that solar energy is one of the most important sources of energy, which is used for heating and cooling of buildings, for cooking food and generating electricity. They are inexhaustible sources of energy and do not cause air pollution, health problem or climate changes. Passive solar energy system often involves architectural design that enhance absorption of solar energy without requiring mechanical power. Active solar energy system uses solar collectors, which are used to heat waters for houses and keep the buildings warm. Photovoltaic is a technology that is used to convert sunlight directly into electricity and is used for various purposes. Hydroelectric power, indirect form of solar energy, is used for generating energy. It has several advantages, but the high construction cost and silting of reservoirs, which lessens the life of power station, are the main drawbacks. Tidal power is another renewable energy resource, but suitable sites for harnessing this energy are limited. So, dear learners, we will come again to meet you with a new program on environmental science. Thank you.